Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Fully Charged. It's been a while. Feels like it's been so long since you, the viewer, since we've had you in. We try to limit these Fully Charged North Americas to sort of big events and important things that happen in TF2, and I don't think that there's been any bigger event in the past several years or more anticipated events than the Meet Your Match update. It's just released for Team Fortress 2, the game we all love. And so we've brought some of our friends together today, myself and Truck, of course, who looks great, by the way. How good does Kurt look?
Yeah, it's me. I'm here.
Good.
Yeah, woohoo!
Yeah, my webcam doesn't work, so here we are.
and we're joined by our friends, of course, Banny and Uncle Dane, who we've brought together to talk about this update, to talk about our thoughts, our impressions on it, and I guess to talk a bit about what it means for the game and what we maybe see going forward. Of course, you guys know Banny. He's probably the most successful competitive player of all time in the game, and he has YouTube and Twitch and stuff too. And Uncle Dane kind of started, did it the other way around, kind of started with the YouTube, but before he got more into the competitive playing stuff. So welcome, guys, and I guess Uncle Dane, this is your first time on Fully Charged, so welcome. Grant is, it's all boring to Manny. he didn't even want to do it. He was saying, you know,
that
he's
is not
above
true
at all. So guys, let's get right into it. And like I said, the first thing I kind of wanted to ask, and people who follow your streams and stuff probably already know this, but maybe starting with Dane. Overall, you don't necessarily have to give it like out of 10 or out of 100, but are you pleased? Do you think that Valve have put something good out? Give me kind of your judgment, and then we'll go into Banny and ask, you know, how satisfied is he?
Sure. So you're asking me to rate this update out of 10?
Yeah, just in general, or give just sort of your, you know, the Cliff's Notes versions. I mean, is it good, not good, not enough, too much?
I think it's great. I think it's exactly what I wanted in TF2, especially the ranking system. I didn't think that they were going to apply that to pubs, first of all. I thought they were going to leave pubs alone and just add the matchmaking system, and I was completely fine with that. And then whenever they announced that they had applied that matchmaking system to pubs, I was worried, but at the same time, whenever I popped into one of them, it's like, it's exactly what I would want in a pub game. Like, people are actually like motivated to try and play the objective, and I think that that's perfect. I mean, if you look at the way that TF2 has been going, like for the last however long it's been a thing, there's never been any motivation to actually try to do anything in a regular game of TF2, and I think that this is a good way to motivate people. So that, I'd give a 10 out of 10, but I'd have to give the overall thing probably a 9 out of 10, docking it for execution, because there were a little bit of mistakes that they had a little bit of an oversight on in the original launch, but they were really fast about fixing them. Like, for instance, like getting penalties for leaving. They fixed that immediately for the casual thing. And then the servers are a little buggy right now, but that's going to go away. So,
of course.
And they said that they're going to add a bunch of stuff that everybody's been saying stuff about. Like, for the last 24 hours, they basically got on it and said, hey, we're going to do exactly what we want. That's amazing. So I think overall, really, really great job on this update. Like, I was hyped to crazy. It was like hyped to like no end, but it's still delivered in my opinion. So.
Maybe overhyped, maybe excessively
a little
hyped.
Bit. Maybe
yeah.
A little bit. Yeah.
Well, and so let's ask you, Banny. I mean, you obviously you've had the benefit of getting to, you know, go and visit Valve, and you spoke to some of the developers kind of ongoing, like some people have in that. So you kind of knew, I guess, maybe ahead of time more of the stuff than the rest of us. What are your impressions when it finally dropped the other day, you know, short form?
Well, I'm pretty happy with the update overall, so I'll just say that first. A lot of the stuff that did come out, I did see when I went there in May, like the casual queue and the competitive interface and all that stuff, and like a list of rebalancing. I actually have a piece of paper here that has all those changes, or a lot of them, that they gave
me.
And we went through this, like, and we talked about all that stuff, but we can talk about that later. Like, it's good, but like he said, like Dane said, there were some issues, some rocky patches there, but I'm glad they fixed a lot of it. A lot of issues, though, I can, like, just using common sense, tell that Valve's going to fix them. So I don't like freak out. It always bothers me when people like lose their minds over things like,
yeah,
I don't know. Yeah. It's just everything. People love to freak out. I'm a little bit more trusting. I think that if something's obviously broken, it will be fixed pretty promptly. So I think that this update is very solid in terms of like the competitive infrastructure being there, the casual queue being there. They just need to iron out a few of the little kinks, and then I think it'll be great. I've played some matchmaking games. I played some casual games earlier today, and I had a good time. Like, the casual was exactly what I want out of pubbing, because for me, it's not really that important what map I play. I'm just trying to play TF2, maybe during some like downtime or whatever, just trying to be silly. I didn't really feel like it was as competitive as Dane was saying. Like, it still felt like a pub. I don't know. There were a lot of new players in there. Like, I went on like a 50 kill streak because people didn't really, I don't know, there were a lot of new players there, but it was fine. It was just TF2, and people didn't really care if there were people running around like being a spy with their fucking spy crab, whatever, going on. But then matchmaking was more like what the competitive people wanted out of it. I admittedly played with a 6-stack, so we were having like very few problems winning or whatever, or playing properly. But we were experimenting with all kinds of stuff, and we were having fun with it still, and I think it was great. And I've heard from a lot of people in my stream or just other people on my friends list, whatever, saying that they're actually having fun playing TF2 again. Because a lot of people weren't really into pugging all the time if they wanted to play or pubbing. So now there's another option for people, and I think that's great. So yeah, I like it a lot.
Oh, I think we all can agree that like the general update is great for the game, but there's a lot of red flags for me personally when it comes to the specifics in the patch notes and where Valve is heading with, where Valve is directing this game as far as balance goes. There's a lot of weapons that have been buffed for seemingly no reason, some weapons that were nerfed for seemingly no reason. I want to know if you're able to let us know what you influenced and what you didn't influence, because things like the medic running faster are questionable. Like, I'm not like hardcore either side because I haven't experienced it enough, but it's definitely like a big red flag for me seeing stuff like the Righteous Bison get nerfed to the ground and be like one of the worst weapons in the game for some reason, and like giving a random air blast mechanic to a scout. Like, I'm just looking at these notes that I have here. Like, they buffed the Sydney Sleeper. It's just very odd. A lot of these buffs and nerfs that they added to the game just seem very random. Like, they seem completely unnecessary and random. Like, what are your thoughts on that, Banny and Dane?
Well, I think on paper, a lot of those are kind of questionable. But after playing for a couple days, a lot of them also didn't play out how I thought they would. The first one that comes to mind is probably the Quickie Bomb Launcher change. I've been using it a little bit in matchmaking or in pubs or whatever, and it really did not feel like it was overpowered to me. I think there are maybe some things that could be tweaked still, but it wasn't like insanely game-breaking. So some things like that are on paper kind of weird, but then when you actually try it, they're not so bad. The medic one, I did not see that one coming. And I'm not really sure how I feel about it. I think overall, like, they're just trying to, I feel like there's a lot of classes that feel kind of neglected, like besides Scout, Soldier, and Demo. And I think that there's some effort being made to make those classes be more just enjoyable and more viable in like the competitive game type of 6v6. As far as like what direction they're going, I'm kind of reminded of the initial first ever meeting we had when we went to Valve back in April of last year, and Robin Walker was there, and he was talking about Dota balance and how in that game they like to sometimes just do crazy things and just see how people react. So there might be some influence there, just to see what people do, how it influences the community and the usage, because now, like, after every change, they actually can collect that data using matchmaking, and they can see how it affects win ratios, how it affects class usage, and all kinds of things like that. So I'm kind of for the experimentation. And again, I'm not freaking out over things like that, because I kind of am trusting that what they said about using the data to make changes is going to happen. So I'm kind of like behind that process, so I'm okay with it. There were, as far as like what influence I had, I went into like this whole situation with a list of priority balances for me, things that were affecting our current competitive sixes and things that I felt were broken. Quick Fix was on my list, Wee Booties, Cozy Camper, like some of the main items that affect competitive sixes. And they changed a lot of those things. Some of the other ones weren't that important to me, I guess. So like I was pretty happy to like breeze over a couple of things, like I don't know, the Eureka effect, or I don't know, the what else is on here? The Huelong heater, like things like that, I'm not too concerned about. Obviously there's more things that could be changed, but again, the process is just going to be like get a list of priority changes and then send it to them. They'll play around with it and make some changes. Like not everything I said was immediately implemented. It was like
right.
It was like they more what they took from what I was saying was what issues are there, and then they came up with their own solutions a lot of times. Maybe sometimes I had a good idea and they kind of took what I had and built on top of it. So that's how that worked.
Yeah, maybe before we move on to Dane, can we just allow you an opportunity? You've gotten a lot of negative feedback, Banny, from people who, I think a lot of people, maybe they believe you work at Valve or something, or you just walk in whenever you want, you teleport there and tell them a thing and they do it. It was a kind of coincidental, of course, that you had a whole thing on Pyro before that happened, but did you have some message to, I mean, Valve is taking feedback from everybody, and maybe their feedback from you, just given your background, is a bit more important, but did you want to set people straight on how, like, you're not, like, the boss or something of, did you have any message for those people?
Yeah, they're just wrong. I don't work at Valve. I haven't received a single penny from Valve. I'm not on their payroll or anything. As much as I'd love to be a member of the TF team in some way, like an official Valve consultant would be awesome, but I am not that. I've been lucky that they've been, you know, happy to take feedback from me. But just the same as anyone else, like I write up the emails and I send it to them. And just like on like Reddit, people are giving feedback, and Valve obviously listened to that. There was like a huge change to casual made directly in response to Reddit, I believe, because people were just losing their minds there. So like Valve is always paying attention to everybody. It's not just me. Things like that Pyro change, like that, I had no idea that was going to happen to the extent that it happened either, and I was blamed for it in a way. It was like they say, any publicity is good publicity, so I just kind of rolled with it. I don't really have anything to do with those kinds of changes. I didn't know that was going to happen. Now I kind of like am tempted to say what I did like directly change so that people can see that I'm not fucking crazy and dumb.
We're going to ask
some of the good changes, I think I like, contributed to, but some of
this
the,
is where
the
you're supposed to do it. Fully
the
charged.
Thing that bothers me is that I understand you're a high-level player. I do trust. I would, as a competitive player myself, trust your decisions. But I don't like, and I'm sure almost everybody doesn't like, the non-transparency that Valve. They're just very ducked away in the corner. Obviously, they're communicating more, but this is directly after an update and after Reddit like blew up. Like, does that have to happen every single time Valve communicates with us? Like I just wish they prioritize communication. I think that would help propel progress much quicker and much more efficient, rather than just like inviting you and just talking to specifically you. Like, would you agree with that, Benny? Like, obviously you think your opinion is the best, and everybody does, don't get me wrong, and I do trust your thoughts on matchmaking and the future of the game, but I think it's just such a slow progress. Mm-hmm. Process, rather.
I mean, there's certainly a lot of things where I would not trust my opinion necessarily on. Like, there are things where I'm not an expert. There are things that, like I'm gonna not even touch on because I feel like I don't really understand it fully. But the things that I do feel like I understand, that's where I am like very vocal with them. But I mean, you have talked to them too, like occasionally on Steam, right? You were in the matchmaking beta.
I helped send the main thing I did with this update was help send Jill demos so they could help optimize the game. I heard the optimization was actually quite nice, so
yeah,
that's pretty much all the communication I've done. I feel like the thing is, if I were able to be on a pedestal, I still wouldn't want it. I'd want the community feedback. I want everybody in the competitive community, because the thing is, like, to propel our game further, it's important that everybody in the community is relatively on the same page. Like, it seems like this casual mode is going to help do that. Like Dane mentioned earlier, and I experienced the exact same thing. People are trying harder in pubs, or at least in the casual mode. They, at very least, are doing the objective. They're not really running around in spawn, like congering, like during the middle of the game. They're playing the game. They wanna get as many points as they can so they can get more experience. But I think people's input is just super important, because, like I was saying earlier, these updates on these, like, some of the things that were changed just make no sense to me. Like, I keep looking at this Righteous Bison. Like, no one in the history of TF2 complained about the Righteous Bison, but if you use it, it is, like, unbelievably bad.
It's garbage.
Like, this
now.
Update.
Useless.
Like, I mean, it's a fun weapon, don't get me wrong. I don't think it needs to be good, but it doesn't need to be, like, strictly worse than a shotgun. Like, it's just so weird to me. Like, it just raises really big red flags for me.
Can I jump in here with a question? I want to ask you, Dane, because we've got kind of just those answers from Banny, and obviously his background is very obvious. He plays at the highest level of 6v6. Your background's very different. I mean, you're a big YouTuber. You stream as well. I know you play MBM and you play all kind different kinds of competitive, including Highlander. Do you feel like, and it's always been kind of a debate in TF2 that when weapon balances come, Valve is balancing the game around the casual game. And I heard you discussing this in a recent video of yours. Do you feel like that's still the case? Do you think that Valve is balancing with a specific group in mind, or do you think they're kind of trying to cover everyone? Do you feel like they're maybe leaning toward competitive now more than ever? What's your thought on what kind of effect our feedback has had on what we just saw?
Well, haven't they already said that they're going to try and, like, make weapons more balanced towards competitive? Like, wasn't that actually, like, just something that they said that they wanted to do? Because I'm assuming that if that was the case, then I'd have to assume that some of these things that they changed in this update had to do with competitive, and some of it didn't. Like, a lot of it, like, especially the ones that Kurt's talking about, that doesn't seem like something that would affect competitive at all. That seems like something that is, like, interesting, or something that we can, like, mess around with, which isn't really something that happens a lot in competitive TF2 in the first place.
More of a bug fix.
Well, to me, it shows that there's, like, no direction. It's like,
yeah,
it's just like random. It's they ignore things like the what's it called, the one that gives a sniper more health. Like, they ignore stuff like that. People have been complaining about that for a while, but they just nerf a random weapon that no one even talks about. Like, that's why I'm talking about the Bison so much. It's just like, what the heck is going on? It's like they buff the Sydney Sleeper, they make the Widowmaker have, like, a random damage buff when a sentry is shooting the same target. Like, that's, like, such an arbitrary buff. Like, it doesn't change anything.
Yeah.
Like, it's just weird to me.
No, I agree. I think that if I had to come up with a guess, then I guess that some things were influenced by the competitive feedback and some things were influenced by just Valve not knowing what we want and what is good for the game. Like, I think that they just felt like trying some stuff in this. For instance, the shortstop shoving people. Like, that's such a random thing. I'm not really sure what that's supposed to do or how that's supposed to make people want to use it, but, you know, who knows? Maybe it'll be used for something someday. Maybe that's what their thought process was for that. But, yeah, I don't know. I can't be sure because, I mean, nobody really knows Valve's thought process or what data they're looking at exactly, but I don't know if there's ever a moment where people were like, they were looking at the Righteous Bison and they said they saw that people were using it too much or something.
This is broken. Yeah. Grant, you weren't asking. You don't have on your sheet there Air Blast for the Scout, do you? I hope. That wasn't one of yours.
I mean, no, that was not mine.
Okay, I'm mostly messing with you.
I don't think
you,
that that matters. Like, again, I think that there's a blend in this update between things that were actual, like, high priority fixes and things that are just like experiments.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but you can understand how it's a point of contention that people look at some problems that are not fixed and haven't been touched, and then right. they see that for some reason the shortstop has an Air Blast now, and say, "Well, why did they have to do that instead of?"
The reason I'm so concerned is, like, the communication isn't there. We don't know why things are the way they are. All we can do is continually speculate and just hope that things get changed for the better more often, and like the casual getting fixed. We could just hope. We don't know.
Well, I think that maybe we could, as a community, try and generate, brainstorm some ideas, a way to fix them. I don't know if that's already a thing that's happened, but just having a priority list of things that need to be changed is probably the best way that they can collect that information. It's just the highest priority things be clearly identified. And they did have Darwin's Danger Shield like on the list, but they obviously didn't change it. So either that means they wanted to just, like, again, it's speculation. You don't know why, but they didn't come up with something that was satisfactory, or they felt like they didn't want to change too many things at once and maybe just limit it right now, see how these things play out, then add new things later. Like, you really don't know. So I mean, I can relate to the feeling of not knowing and just having to speculate, but like, I don't know.
It could be the last reason you said, because I mean, in this last blog post they mentioned that a reason that they didn't roll out the ability to choose maps, like whenever you're logging up, they said that they didn't add that because they didn't want to add too much at once, which is like, but we want that. So I mean, maybe they should be a little bit more liberal about what they add to updates, because I mean, I feel like they're too afraid to add too much at once or something, if that's the case.
Yeah, it could be, but I mean, maybe that will mean we'll get more regular updates or something, like, who knows. Because I know that they showed interest in making the competitive thing like into a seasonal based thing, so there'd be more regular sort of checkpoints in the whole process of competitive and all that stuff, and maybe that's when they'll do their evaluation on the data they have and make changes again.
I guess we could transition to that too. So, Dane, I know you play a lot of Highlander. I know you do a fair amount of pubs as well. Like, you're not very much a sixes player. Have you played 6v6 matchmaking, and like, what are your critiques? What do you like? What do you don't like about it?
Yeah, I mean, I played the beta as long as it was out, and I played it a lot, and I liked it a lot, because I mean, as far as sixes goes, like, I played a little bit of it, but it wasn't one of my favorite game modes to play, simply because I like to have more options, and the way that the 6v6 meta has been set up by the community, and understandably, is to make it so that games don't drag on forever, and so that there aren't a whole bunch of frustrating things in the game. And that's completely understandable, and I understand why it happens. But at the same time, I wish that there would have been some way for there to be options for more people. Like, for instance, me, I like playing engineer, and I like playing like spy sometimes, and like heavy, and things that aren't necessarily full-time in sixes. And that stuff's been kind of obviously shut off in the community sixes for obvious reasons, but this 6v6 is kind of the answer to that, mostly because Valve is like making it so that those classes make sense to play in that game mode, right? So I like the 6v6 game mode that Valve has come out with. It makes it feel more like everybody has a chance to do something, like Spy's played more, Pyro's played more, all that stuff. So I mean, it makes sense. I like it. So I guess that's generally my answer, is that I like it a lot, and I've been having fun with it ever since the beta was out.
Maybe we could talk about this whole idea of no class limits and weapon bans, but I'm more concerned about the class limits, because this was a big discussion when the beta was out, is like, should you be able to have a team of six heavies or six whatever the hell you want? You know, there are class limits now in professional leagues and whatnot. And some people were thinking maybe Valve will say, you know, class limit 2 for everything, or maybe it'll be, you know, similar to what the league class limits are, or maybe it'll be nothing. And as of right now, it's no class limits. And we'll stick right with you, I guess, Dane, first, and then we can ask Grant. Do you think no class limits is good or bad or no? You think
I personally think that it probably would be better if there were class limits. I don't know exactly what class limit there should be, but I know that playing against two medics isn't very fun. Playing against three heavies isn't very fun. Playing against four scouts isn't very fun. Playing against four engineers isn't fun. Like, I feel like a class limit would be nice. We should at least try it.
Benny, were you surprised that there was no class limits with the competitive that they came out with?
I don't think I'm surprised, no. I mean, it was in the beta. I didn't think they were going to change it. I think they want to just experiment with it. I think there could potentially be more testing with that, maybe less than 6 class limit on some of them. But at this point, I don't know what's going to happen with that. But I'm honestly not even sure how I feel about no class limits in matchmaking, at least, because I haven't had the chance of like playing against a team that's like tryharding when they're on some crazy composition while we run standard sixes lineups. And because I've always wondered, is the sixes lineup actually going to beat them, or does running some stack of scouts win no matter what? It's something I'm not sure about. If the class limits don't actually like play that big a role, I don't know. It's something I'd be willing to just keep in matchmaking, but then that brings up the debate with the leagues that we have, whether that should be like changed to mimic what we see in matchmaking. And I don't think our community's really had that debate yet, and that's probably something that should happen sooner than later. I don't know.
Yeah, what are your thoughts on that? Do you think the community, like next season of ESEA, UGC, whatever, do you think they should just be like, all right, it's Val's game now. Give them all the data they want with these games. Obviously, there might be some suffering involved, but do you think that would help them progress with the balance? Or do you think they won't really take that into account?
I think it would definitely help with our ability to give feedback on it, and that would progress the changes that could be made to improve it. But I would like to see no weapons be banned eventually. It just is a matter of them getting balanced to a point where they fit within sixes. But then the problem is maybe they fit within sixes with no class limits. So it's really hard to say. I would be interested in seeing like us commit to loosening our whitelist though a little bit. I know ETF2L actually has a looser whitelist than we do in ESEA. And I don't think they're like playing super like disorganized games or anything crazy is going on over there. So I think we could start moving in that direction, kind of like maybe make some sort of goal that within the next year or something, we have a like almost empty whitelist or something. I don't know.
Do you think that's the utopian thing too, Dane, that eventually the game is balanced so that it doesn't matter that there's no class limits or weapon limits? Is that kind of like the ultimate? Yeah.
I mean, like, that's always kind of what I've been hoping that they've been working towards, because I mean, even in Highlander, they have weapon bans, and I still thought that was annoying. Like, I want to play with all of the options. So, I mean, Highlander on its own is not exactly a balanced game mode by any means. It's largely based on snipers and spam. So it's, you know, if they're going to be balancing the game around sixes, then hopefully they can balance the weapons around that to the point where nobody has to ban anything. And I think that would be great. I would like that a lot.
Dane, how do you feel about this current situation with Highlander? It seems like Valve is kind of ditching Highlander for this casual mode and competitive mode. What do you think about that? Do you think it's enough, or do you still think the Highlander community is kind of getting shafted with this update?
I mean, the Highlander community is getting shafted with it, but I personally don't really care. I mean, I liked playing Highlander because it gave me the option to play whatever class I wanted, even if it was full-time. And it, I guess, was just closer to what I was familiar with, which was pubs. So I I liked it the most because it was I don't know, it was just, it was the game mode that I found fun. But what I find fun in TF2 is working together to achieve this common goal. Like, that's all that I find fun, and there was no way to do that in pubs before. So since pubs is getting a little bit more like that, and 6v6 is like that already, and I can just play whatever the heck I want, it's whatever. So I'm fine with it. I mean, I'm sure people will miss it, but I probably won't.
That's pretty cool. It seems like, I mean, obviously your opinion isn't the entire like community's opinion, but it is cool to have your thoughts on that. It seems like Valve did a good job with trying to bring the communities together, giving people what they want without ruining people's game modes and whatnot. But yeah. Oh, yeah. What I wanted to touch on here was some of the options in matchmaking are kind of peculiar. The view model FO, or excuse me, like the min mode view model, I think it's called. Mm-hmm. What do you guys think about that? Like, do you think it's better? It's like a good solution to not having view models, or what?
I don't know. It's changed, so it's scary, right? But yep. I mean, I think that once people get used to it, they'll like it. It's a good in-between, because I played with view models off sometimes, but when I stream, I have to play with view models on most of the time, because people are like, where's your weapon? And I'm like, fine, whatever, I'll turn it back on.
Where's your hand?
Yeah, like, I can't. If people want to know, I guess, what gun you're shooting, they don't want to look in the corner. So it's a good in-between, I think. It doesn't take up a whole lot of the screen, and you can tell what weapon you're using, I guess, from an outside perspective.
And I guess beyond that, I guess, Benny, your thoughts on that as well?
So I kind of understand and accept that view models off is something that they're just not, they don't, they're kind of, I don't know, for whatever reason, they're against it. And I think the min view models are a good compromise. Transparent view models were something that were discussed before, but apparently they've abandoned that, or they've shelved it for now, and min view models are the solution we have right now. And I actually like the min view models. I think they're nice. It would just be, I think it would be fine to add in a little bit more customization with the view model FOV and things like that, or maybe eventually an X position, Y position commands, things like that, so you could customize it a little bit more. But that's another one of those things where I'm not like freaking out about, because I can't imagine that they would keep view model FOV stuck at 54. I just don't think they will allow no view models, and I've kind of accepted it. Some of the other graphic settings, I would hope they would loosen a little bit, but that might take a little bit of time.
Yeah, that seems peculiar for me, because personally I'm having a little bit of trouble with the view model FOV and the min mode. I feel like, I don't know, I feel like cross-eyed or something when I'm playing with it. It's yeah, something it
takes some
odd
getting
about
used
it.
To.
Some of the models are weird too. Like, Kurt, you were having trouble with you had one of the holiday
the
weapons.
Festive
and it was just, yeah,
back burner
just
takes
up in
up,
your face.
I want to say like 30 or 40% of the screen if you have it
is
equipped.
Is it more than it used to?
Well, I
well,
usually
yeah,
play with 90
play with
FOV, so.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, it's pretty hilarious, but.
But the
maybe
point
that
I
will
made
change.
Is,
I hope it does.
Yeah. One point I made as well that I kind of thought of last night is, you've got to understand, I guess, and then we have to understand. I mean, I don't like the huge view models. I hate it. It's terrible. But, you know, there's for every one person that doesn't like the view models, there's probably 100 new players or pub players who don't even know the difference and don't even know that you can change that. And so it's like they haven't even noticed a change. You know what I mean? Just as a kind of counterpoint to that. It's kind of just a side note. I'm not really going anywhere with
yeah,
that.
But. Well, I think that's important to like consider, because there's a huge community in TF2 that's involving people from all kinds of skill levels, but
yep.
The truth is the largest like demographic in the player base is a lot of those more casual players, and Valve has to keep them in mind too, and they also have to keep in mind their experience when they go to look into matchmaking and when they go to watch a stream and all that stuff. So it's kind of a complicated situation, and I feel for Valve that they have to deal with it, but I'm glad that they're willing to make compromises.
Yeah. Well, how about maybe we can talk about that, about sort of, there's been always sort of this rift between like kind of two sides, like the more casual community and the competitive community, or, you know, use the word rift or whatever you want to call it. Do you guys think that with this change, with sort of making casual more similar to competitive, and obviously now everyone's going to know the competitive's a thing, it's not some crazy dark mystery of the world now, do you think that the rift between those two groups, do you think it's going to get better? Do you think it'll stay the same, or what, Dane?
It already is getting better. You guys invited me on your show, so.
True.
I mean, yeah, I guess so. It'll take a while, but I think that the competitive community is so small and so tight-knit that, like, not a whole lot of people even knew that it existed before, so I don't know if there was a rift so much as just a, like, they didn't even know that it existed. And once you become a part of the competitive community, you kind of start to lose, like, sight of what it was like to be part of the casual community too. So I guess there is kind of like this, not so much an imbalance or something. It's more of like they don't know how each other feels very much. So I guess it'll get better.
You have a big audience. Oh, sorry. Yeah, I was going to say, Grant, you have a big audience too, of all kinds of different people. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I think the transition is going to be much smoother now. And I try to do my part. Like, if there's new people that come onto the stream, or if I meet someone in a server or whatever and they're interested, like, I'm going to try and get them the resources they need to get into competitive or whatever. I do a lot of directing of people to TFTV and newbie mixes and stuff like that. Maybe TFTV isn't the best place, and maybe that's another attitude we have to change, is having people be a little bit more welcoming, because right now it seems like TFTV is not, it's not the most hospitable place for new people. So I don't know, that's a whole nother topic, I guess. But yeah, I think it's going to be easier with matchmaking being right there. People are going to try it out. People might, you know, what I noticed was, like, I was obsessed with my rank. I wanted to just keep ranking up, and I, like, felt much more invested in the game. And if other people are feeling the same way, I think our community is going to strengthen quite a bit with just the interest in competitive in that way.
Well, can I ask you a contrarian question then? Maybe a controversial one? Because, again, I was watching some of your guys' videos and stuff on YouTube, and Dane, you mentioned a thing in a recent one, which I think a lot of people have been asking, is, like, in competitive mode, is it going to be just a rank that you're fighting for, or are there going to be some kind of crazy weapons or drops or something that we'll get as well as rewards? Obviously, there's golden weapons already as MVM rewards, and there's another FPS game, I'm told, which is giving people golden weapons in their competitive thing. Do you think a rank is enough? And this is for either of you guys. Or do you think maybe down the road Valve will be trying to add more incentives, I guess? Is it enough?
Oh, I feel like it's maybe a little too early to tell, but I think that it couldn't hurt to add more incentives to ranking up as people kind of lose interest, I guess. Because, I mean, there are going to be people who are into it for a while and they're going to lose interest. People just have that mentality sometimes. So I can see it happening, just for the reason of just kind of trying to get people back into it. But I think that it couldn't hurt. But as far as it is right now, I think it's fine.
Yeah, I agree. I think more incentives or rewards or something, competitive contracts, things like that, that's all you really need. So yeah, I think it'll improve. If right now, it will hold people's interest because it's new, and then, like, in the near future, if they come out with something new, it'll bring people right back. I think it'll be good.
All right, so you both seem to really like this update. For both of you, if you could pinpoint one specific problem that, whether or not you think it's actually a problem or potentially a problem, just name one problem that might come up through this update, whether it be a weapon or some sort of change.
For me, I think the main problem that exists right now is just queue times, but I think that they've already mentioned that is something that they're, like, furiously working on. So I think once that improves, then there will be a lot less complaints and people will be enjoying their time a lot more. It'll be that streamlined experience that we all want, or at least I want.
That doesn't count as an answer because they're fixing it. You just said yourself you can't use that as an answer.
I wouldn't take that as an answer.
Nice try, buddy.
I don't even want to like say like they're something that they aren't going to fix. Like they haven't said they are going to fix. Like what is like. So this update can't be perfect. Like a lot of people are upset in every community. Obviously, like the Reddit community, like the Pover community, they're getting casual fixed. And personally, I played casual all day today. It was super fun. But like, there's a lot of questionable things that I touched on earlier. Would you agree with any of it? That they might not be heading in the right direction with some of the items and whatnot?
I'm worried about people's reactions to them not bringing back the classic pub servers, because they haven't said anything about that yet, right? So I'm worried that people will just refuse to figure out how to work the server browser and just quit. Like, that's the only thing that I'm concerned about for this update, I guess, because people are dumb and they don't want to figure stuff out. So, like,
that's great. I didn't have to say it.
It's like the average person, I feel like, is gonna, they're not involved, like people who aren't even involved in the sub communities like Reddit or whatever, they're gonna load up the game and they're gonna be like, what is this? I can't find my pubs. I guess I'm just not gonna play this game anymore. So, I don't know if that was gonna make it more obvious, or I'm worried that they maybe put too much faith in the community servers to like pick up the slack. So I guess, but at the same time, I feel like they probably will. It's just probably going to take a long time. Not a long time, but like it's not going to be instant.
I mean, I'm glad I'm the guy, not the guy that had to say it's user error, that these people just can't figure it out in their heads. But do you think, I mean, there was a lot of for people to make new community servers?
good question.
I think you
need to rephrase it.
None of that.
No,
was,
repeat it.
Was
you were roboting. The server was lagging.
Maybe someone else go ahead and. I'll type it out in mobile.
No, we can hear you. We can hear
you.
Am I
okay now?
It was the whole server.
You're good now.
Okay. Community servers, for a long time, they were a huge thing, and then they died out. Yeah, I was looking at your guys' faces, being like, is there a spider on my head? Is this good, do you think? Does this maybe open the door for community servers to kind of make a comeback and for more people? I've heard from a lot of people already that they're going to open their own community server. Because the other thing is now, too, now that there's all this talk about quick play, a lot of people are going and looking for that experience and looking for these servers where they can just pop in and pop out, even though Valve is fixing casual. But to stop rambling, I mean, is this good, do you think? Can community servers sort of come back with this?
I mean, you mentioned that people are saying that they're going to open up their own servers. I have the power, too, so I might as well as well. So, I mean, especially since I can tell people, hey, if you miss that original pub experience, if you're not into the concept of trying the objective, if you want the option of pop in and pop out without having to lobby up or whatever, then that will be there. But right now, I feel like because it was killed off, it's not good right now. There's very few of those servers that exist right now. Most of the servers are like times 10, all crits or whatever. Like, people want to play vanilla TF2 now. So those servers are going to have to either adapt to that, or there's going to have to be a whole new host of servers that bring that demand to completion. So, but at the same time, I am kind of like wondering why Valve thought it would be a good idea to just drop it all on them at once, you know? Like, say, hey, I know we killed you guys off like 2 years ago, but like, here, come back now and fix this. I don't know. It's weird, but that's probably my least favorite part about the update, I guess.
What do you think, Ben? Oh, sorry. Yeah. Go ahead.
Go ahead, Benny.
Well, as far as the servers go, I do understand that a lot of people have issue with that. I think I just want something different out of pubbing. So I don't really care what map I'm on ever. I'd rather be surprised. But yeah, I think having some solution, Valve servers being open again or whatever, I imagine it'll do something like that, though, because I do also lack the faith in people's ability to go to the community server tab and find the right server. But I have been thinking about, you know, opening up another server to be a pub. I do have an MGE server, so I could just open up another one that's just a pub. It's been really, really, really hard to populate in the past, though. Like, maybe if they keep it the way it is, then that will change. But I felt it wasn't worth it when quick play was around. So maybe that is a good thing. Maybe it's a bad thing. It can just bring more community feel to the servers, which is nice. Do I think that that's the biggest issue? Again, like, that's the reason I don't feel like that's the biggest issue is just because I think that that's going to be fixed. And then I guess I'd just like to see more rebalancing, like a focus on that now.
Now, do you think it's going to be fixed? Foundation. Like, do you think that they're going to make it easier to navigate the server browser, or at least connect to like popular community servers?
I think they'll at least make it easy to connect to Valve servers. That would be my prediction, but I actually have no reason to.
But Valve servers right now are lobbied up. Like, you have to lobby up to join them right now, right?
Yeah, like the Valve pub is gone as of right
now. Yeah, but people don't want to lobby up. Like, it's dumb, but like, people don't want to wait 2 minutes to join a game. They want to join right away.
Yeah, I think if I had to predict, I think they would open up just old style pubs as well, because right now I think they're all locked or something. They're like Valve maintenance servers right now.
Yeah, they converted them. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I think they might convert them back. That would be my prediction, but again, it's a prediction.
Okay. That would be a good idea.
Yeah. So I think that just more balance would be nice, because I think that what they've done well with this update is just laid sort of the foundation, and now I just think they should build on top of it, do more like experiments, and keep using that data. That's what I'm honestly most excited about, is the implementation of the data and the changes that they can make with it, because I think that gives them a little bit more free rein to like make pretty big changes.
The only problem with that kind of method is that is time. Like, what if all these top level TF2 players are just sick of playing a game that's like under maintenance all the time, and they just want to like have their game grow as quickly as possible? Like, the fact that Valve is not really communicating, I mean, they are doing it a little bit more recently, but it just seems like things are happening so slowly. People are getting very impatient, as we've seen a lot of top players like leave the game due to real life complications or whatever, just getting older because it's taking so long. Like, for example, like matching was confirmed what, 3 years ago, and now we have it. I mean, it's a feat that they actually were able to put it in the game, but like, do you think they will be able to push these updates quicker? Like, what do you think will cause them to do that if that's the case?
I mean, they just came out with a major update like on Thursday, so I don't know why we're like so upset saying that we need more. Like, I just don't get it. I'm a patient person. I get it that some people are going to move on, but I'm not going to sit here and like beg them to stay or whatever. So like, the changes are going to come when they're ready. It's how it's always been. I don't know, man. I guess I don't have an answer
that's going to make you happy about the timeline. You know what I mean? Like, I'm patient. I've been around since day one. Like, we all waited. I'm personally not disappointed with this update at all. Like I was mentioning, my only concerns are the questionable decisions with some of the balancing. But overall, I think this update is absolutely fantastic. It's just, I wish there was just some way that Valve could tell us, like, hey, we want to talk to you. We want to have a back and forth to the community. But I guess we'll see if that happens.
Yeah, Kurt's question never got back around to Dane. Dane, if you had to pick something that sticks out to you as being kind of, you can't say the server is being down because they're kind of working on it. Is there anything that sticks out as kind of a weird or still broken or something that's still there sticking out to you?
Like a broken part of it? Like something that you think is going to be fixed later?
Something questionable or something that's still broken or whatever. Like, what sticks out in your head when you're thinking like well, they still need to work on this?
Like a weapon or a class or something?
Could be anything. A weapon, it could be anything. Sky's the limit.
I mean, I don't know if you guys are ever going to segue into the whole heavy versus pyro thing that they're doing, but I do think that pyro needs to be changed still. I think that a lot of things about its flamethrower especially are frustrating because they're inconsistent, so that's something that needs to be changed, which is why I'm voting for the pyro. I don't like pyro at all. Like, it's not fun to play against because it's so inconsistent, and I'd like that to be fixed, so that's why I'm voting for it. And I think a lot of people are, like, confused about the whole heavy versus pyro thing because I think they think that they're supposed to vote for the best class, or something.
Yeah.
That's not the case. You're supposed to vote for the worst one.
Yeah, people on my stream, I was clarifying. I was like, well, if you think that this class needs to be fixed the most, you should vote for them. You shouldn't be thinking they're crappy. It's maybe understated or maybe underexplained, the whole heavy versus pyro thing. I mean, we're talking about how the community serverless needs friggin' arrows and neon lights to it. Do you think that people have understood fully this heavy versus pyro thing?
No, I don't think so, because one, I was playing a bunch of the casual things last night, and so many people playing heavy, so many people playing pyro. I think that they think it's like the last war where you have to play as a specific class and kill the other class in order to get points, but that's not the case at all. I think that that wasn't explained very well.
Do you think it was kind of an afterthought, Banny, or do you think they just maybe did a bad job explaining it, or?
It's probably just a failure to communicate. I even found myself getting like confused and having to like correct myself. Oh, right, I don't actually have to play pyro ever, and I can still contribute. So
thank
I think
God.
Some people just have that confusion. I don't know. And also, I think that a lot of people are forgetting that the thing that you're voting for is the one that you want to see, like, almost completely reworked, maybe, or just see changed in, like, a drastic way or improved or whatever. And both of them will eventually get it. So, I mean, in the end, this war thing doesn't really matter, maybe, like, who wins. Ultimately, every class is like eventually like up for rebalancing or whatever, and I think that's pretty exciting. Like the shift back to these class focused updates, and that actually is like that should be something that people should be more excited about, I think, because that means that when the war ends, we have like a timeline for when the next major change to TF2 is going to be happening. Because I think people forget that that actually hasn't happened yet. That's not part of this update. That's a future update that's like guaranteed to come. So
there will be another update.
That's a good point.
Confirm.
Would you guys agree, like, an ideal world that all the classes are balanced, or do you think it's important that there is a bit of imbalance, there is a bit of a specialist class? So would you think it would be better in the future of TF2 if the specialist class were used more often or used as much as the quote-unquote main classes right now?
Well, I personally like the way that TF2 works with the specialist and generalist sort of style, and I think that with the way that the game works is that the strengths of a lot of the off classes are offset by like huge weaknesses, and in order to like make the classes more viable, you'd have to pretty much target their weaknesses very like you'd have to focus really like on eliminating those weaknesses. And like for heavy, for example, the mobility, you kind of already see it happening with like a GRU or the disciplinary action. Like getting rid of the heavy's mobility has kind of it leaves open the possibility of kind of making the heavy full-time viable, but then his strengths are not really addressed at all by targeting his weaknesses. So it's a pretty complicated task to balance out all those aspects of the classes, you know. So I think I'd rather see them maintain sort of the current way it is with the off classes kind of being just specialists. But if they were going to completely rework the classes, then, you know, they could probably do it in a way where it would be okay. So if there was a way where they could like make the heavy not be a massive fast tank, but instead have a little bit more, a little bit more mobility, but less firepower. I don't know, some way. It, like, the thing is, they can be very creative with these kinds of things, and I think we might be underestimating that, because the new subclasses or whatever that they introduced could be as drastic as the Demo Man to the Demo Knight sort of for a heavy, and that could just be completely mind-blowing. Like, I can't even think of what a heavy subclass could be, really. So
yeah, Dane, I mean, what are your thoughts on that? I want to get Dane's perspective, because it could definitely be different. Like, do you think it would be better if it was every class was even, or would you agree with Banny that
I'd say that that's probably the biggest difference between me and Banny, is that like I think that each class should have an opportunity to be played as much as possible, instead of like there being specialists and generalists, right? So my goal overall, I think, would be to make it so that whenever you're playing, like whenever you lobby up into a 6v6 game and you're with randos or with your whether you're with your friends, you're not going to have classes that are a must pick, and you're not going to have classes that are a never pick. Like, for instance, if somebody picked Spy or something, then you wouldn't roll your eyes or something like that. You wouldn't be like, oh God, what's this guy doing? Or if somebody picked Engineer, then they wouldn't be like, what are you doing on Engineer? Pick one of the more, you know, specialist classes or generalist classes, right? I think that that would be better for the general audience of TF2, but I understand the need for specialists and generalists at the same time, just as a balance thing, because it is harder to balance around all classes being viable. So I understand, like, that it's a little bit less of a there's more of a shortcut to what their original goal for TF2 was, which was specialist and generalist. And honestly, as the way that it is now, I think that it's fine. I don't really think that they have to deviate much from what they have now.
Yeah, I mean, it's always evolving too. I mean, I don't think any of us believe that they'll ever finally get to a place where it's like the game is perfectly done and it's finished, because people's play styles always evolve and the leagues change and evolve and whatnot. I want to kind of, maybe as a bit of a wrapping up question, ask. A lot of people were talking about how when this update comes down, it's going to be the new era of TF2, or the renaissance of TF2. I want to ask each of you, does it feel like that to you right now, or do you think that some more stuff has to happen before we get there? Does this feel like as monumental of an update as we were maybe thinking? Go Dane first, and then we'll ask Ben.
Well, I certainly didn't expect it to happen overnight, but I think that we're on our way. I think that this is a good step in the right direction, because I'm having a lot of fun, because I'm at the point where I have gotten bored in pubs, because it's, especially playing Engineer, like, obviously I'm well known for playing Engineer most of the time because it's my favorite class, but Engineer in pubs where nobody's supporting you or there's just random stuff going on, like, that's so difficult to play with. And these last couple days playing in the casual mode even, I'm getting people who are, like, actually trying to support me. And that's a lot of fun. And I think a lot of players who are both newer to the game and just, like, literally installing the game today are going to have a lot of fun with that, I think. But it just comes down to giving it a chance, I think.
What do you think, Ben?
I agree with everything you just said. I think it'll take a little bit of time before we see the full impact of this update. But I think it's really laid down that foundation that we needed. And without it, there would be no hope of us, like, seeing TF2 to its full potential. So I think... I mean, there's a lot of people that are, once they're satisfied, once all the changes have been made, once all the kinks have been ironed out, I think this update will be the one that really sort of, like, unites the casual and competitive, and that will set us up to sort of, I don't know, take on the future of competitive TF2 and just have the game surviving and thriving. And I don't know, everything's set up now. So now we just gotta believe in it, support it, keep giving feedback, keep playing. And I don't know, we'll see what happens again, but I think it's good.
Everyone tell their friends.
Yeah, that too.
Yeah.
The ball's Kurt? In the air, you just gotta windmill slam dunk it.
Pretty much.
I don't know what that is.
An alley-oop, gotta well.
Kurt, any other topics? We're kind of winding down, approaching about an hour here now. What else?
I think Banny and Dane did a good job of basically... countering the cynicism with optimism, and I was trying to be like the counter argument, even though I'm kind of on their side still. It's just like, things are gonna change. Get off your soapboxes, man. I mean, if you want to cry about something, definitely make it more appropriate and constructive. That's the word.
That's huge because I know a lot of people that their idea of constructive criticism is delete this from the game. And that's just so, it's so annoying to see that, because I think that the approach that I've had, and part of the reason why I think that Valve is, like, more receptive to things that people like me say, is that we're a lot more objective and, I don't know, we're not so hysterical about this stuff. It's so important to just give actual feedback instead of just complaining. There's a big difference.
And I mean, I feel like the things people are complaining about are a lot smaller. It's more of the smaller things, whereas all the positive stuff is all the bigger kind of stuff and the philosophies and the fact that Valve says they're listening and that they're... I mean, did you guys hear those new voice lines they have? And this is for people who haven't heard them. The voice lines they re-recorded with the voice actors in the game,
there's like so many of
40
them.
Minutes of them, and they're talking about scrims and flanks and poking fun at like the off-classers and stuff. Like, it's really cool.
The amount of polish in this update is unreal.
Yeah. People haven't listened to those, you should go check them out, because they're actually they're hilarious. Great. They're very funny, some of them. But yeah, I feel like people are going to nitpick over the small stuff, which is fine. It doesn't bug me too much as long as they're not being stupid, but it's cool to see some of the bigger stuff and to see the bigger stuff. I don't know how to say it.
You know, it was also good. We had a big ESEA match on the day of the update, and I think that there were a lot of new people that were able to tune into that because of the update. So hopefully we get more stuff like that happening.
Yeah, yep. We might actually have, I think that would be a good topic for the next Fully Charged. After like maybe another week of ESEA matches, maybe we'll get a couple invite players and have their thoughts on how the current meta is changing and what they think. Because that type of feedback, I think, is vital to push at least the highest level of competitive game, a competitive TF2 forward. And that's very important, especially when it comes to our broadcasts.
Yeah. Well, I think we're winding down here, guys. I don't know. I was thinking, did either of you have any big suggestion? Because, I mean, maybe Valve are listening right now. Maybe they're in Twitch chat, you know, posting PogChamps. Is there some big thing that they need to get on right away? Probably not, but I thought I'd throw it out there.
Nothing big that I can think of. Just that Pompson fix didn't do anything.
No. There were a lot of changes to NG. I mean, are you overall, how did they do?
I think the teleporters costing a lot less is going to make it a lot easier to play engineer on like 5 CP, because you can actually build teleporters and not have to waste your time, I feel. Because you can build like an entrance and then an exit and then still be able to build a mini. So that's like really useful, I think. Other than that, all of the rest of them are kind of like eh. The Widowmakers seem like Curtin mentioned it earlier. I don't understand the Widowmaker buff at all. Like,
when are you ever shooting at the same target as your gun?
Oh, I don't know.
Well, it
maybe every time
accident.
I play, all the time. Yeah, it's like, yeah. I don't know. Yeah. But what engineer isn't building sentries? Like,
yeah. We can all laugh at it. Any big thing? Banny, that they need to, you know?
Well, I'm thinking about a list of more things that I'd like to see changed, but it's not major things right now. I'm gonna try and, you know, point them towards more customization with crosshairs, view models, damage numbers, things like that. I think those things are important. Maybe some more map fixes, like they fixed granary and Badlands a little bit. So maybe see some changes to like Viaduct or something in the future. That'd be pretty cool. So those are the things that I'm going to start thinking about. Also being like very paying attention to more weapon balance things. So it's just a lot of small things that I think still need to happen.
Cool. Well, I think that's about it, Kurt. So we can get mods to, you know, tell people where to find these two guys. They're easy to find if you know how to spell Banny with a 4, and if you know how to type Uncle Dane, you'll find them. But when we're wrapping up the show here, we want to send you guys over to the Sideshow stream, because our boy Sideshow, who is a pillar of the community, an actual pillar of the community, is having his last stream ever, his final. It's a 24-hour stream. I've been urged to send people there. I didn't have to be urged. I was there earlier and I donated. He's done a whole lot for this game. He's a funny guy and he goofs around and does stuff, but the amount of stuff he's done for us, for the competitive side of the game, and for just everything, it's really great and can't be understated. So someone I'm sure is going to post the hell out of that link. Go and at least say goodbye to him and tell him you love him. He needs the love. He needs that. He's gentle. He's a soft, vulnerable, little young man. But that's really it then for Fully Charged. Kurt, what do you think? We did it.
We did it, Mike. It was fun. And we should probably continue to do it.
Kurt, you haven't been moving the whole
time. I know.
Are you okay?
Maybe next week I'll get my webcam working.
Yeah,
maybe.
Hopefully.
Or no, that's me forever.
That's you. I'm frozen.
So fully charged, you're trying to make it weekly now, or what?
Probably when events happen, we'll keep it up. And I think next week or 2 weeks from now, like I mentioned, it'd probably be wise to get high-level players' opinions on the big changes on this update, because I think most teams have played maybe one match, if that. So it's probably not going to do that just yet. But
we'll have to check in. That'll be a future fully charged.
Get
we'll
the calendars out.
Get the status update on how it is a couple weeks later. But yeah, I don't think we had anything else, people. We're pleased that you all decided to come and join us this evening. And absolutely, you know how to find these guys. If you want to offer your own feedback, I know a lot of people had it in the chat, and we just can't do it all. But come to teamfortress.tv if you haven't already. And it's what's that? Am I here? Hello? Hello?
Hi, I hear you.
Hi. Am I still here? Am I a robot?
No, you're
we
fine.
Hear you.
Go to teamfortress.tv. A lot of great discussion there. That's all I wanted to say.
All right.
I guess that's it. All right, thank you, everybody. I'll see you in Sideshow Stream, and thanks for watching.